I'm going to share a couple of scriptures. At least one scripture we're going to begin with is in Isaiah chapter number 55, verses number 6 through verse number 9. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. I'm going to share with you today God's perfect plan. And I want you to know God has a plan. Do you believe that? Yes. And not only does he have a plan, but his plan is perfect. And his plan has each one of us in it. There's a destiny, a hope, and a future for each one of us. No one is here by accident. You're not here in this place because of accident or happenstance. You're in a predestined place at a predestined time. And God has something that he wants to share with you today. So in Isaiah, he's sharing with them that his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. So whatever way we have that we want to do it, it may not be God's way. And I believe that God has a better way. He knows more about us than we could ever know about ourselves. He created us. He's our waymaker. He's our creator. You know, whenever you have a problem, you take the part back to the manufacturer because they made it. And when you take your problem, your issues, your concern back to God, that is the best place where you can go. He made you and he knows all about you. Every moving part in your life, everything that's not working, God already knows. And you have access to the manufacturer, to our creator. But he says that his ways are not your ways. So whatever way you're thinking about doing it, rethink that and say, is this God's way? Is this God's thoughts? When I was younger, there was a point where I knew everything, around 18 or so. You may have been there too, where you knew it all at 18. You didn't know anything else. When somebody was trying to tell me something, my response was, I know, I know, I know, I know, I know. And when I got old, I found out I didn't know. And the older I get, the less I find out that I know. I think when you get old, I'll find out I don't know anything. After a while, I don't know anything. I don't know. I tell my children now, I always look for people who are smarter than I am. And I find out that's a lot of people. If you look around, there are people that are willing to help you. And God will put them in your way so that they will be there to help you at your time of need. But sometimes the people that God puts in your way may not look like you or act like you or think like you or may not even like you. But that's okay. God loves you. You ever had to get through the bad or go through the bad to get to the good in something? Sometimes you've got to do that. You got to go through some bad to get to the good. Now, the bad sometimes, what we perceive as being bad, because bad is all about perspective, isn't it? What you think was a bad day could turn out to be one of your best days. So when God has a way, God is sometimes putting you out of your own way, because we can get in our own way sometimes. I've been in my own way. If I could just move out of my way, I could see God's way. But sometimes we keep trying to tell God how to do it. No, God, over here. No, God, this way. And God's trying to show us the way that he desires us to go. You know, there are two ways that a person can be lost. A person cannot know where they are or not know where they're going. Both ways, you're lost. Life is like a directory. When you go to a directory, you see all of these locations, all of these directions, all of these possibilities. But before we can go anywhere, you've got to know where you are. And the directory usually says something like, you are here, so that you can navigate from here how to get where you're going. If you do not know where you are right now in your life, you do not know where you're going. You are lost. It's better to get directions. Isn't that right? You ever had a father who never asked for directions? We would travel and my dad would be lost. I'd know he'd be lost. We're kids and we know he was lost. And the more lost he go, the faster he drive. My mother would say, "You're lost." He said, "Well, we're making good time." Always, never admitted that he was lost. We figured if he goes sooner or later, he would see something that he recognized and he would find his way there. It was raining one night and one man was, the visibility was poor. And he was driving on the freeway, so he started following this car ahead of him because it looks like the car was going exactly in the same direction and place where he was going. So he just started following this car. And finally gets to this place where the car stops. And he's right behind it, and the car shuts off the lights. And he's thinking, what's wrong with this person? Stopping. He honks his horn, and the person gets out. He comes back, and he says, "What are you doing stopping in the middle of the road?" He says, "Man, I'm in my driveway. What are you talking about?" So when we follow the wrong people, we can end up in the wrong places, can't we? You've got followers on Instagram. I've got a lot of people that follow me and people that haven't met, people all over the country. And they're following. I'm following you. And you may follow people, but you've got to know where the ones are going that you're following. Because if they're lost, then you've got the blind leading the blind or the lost leading the lost. My first question to you, do you know where you are? And if we go back to that scripture, seek the Lord while he may be found, call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord and he will have mercy. When we get old enough, we want to try to find our way. You know, there's the way that your parents taught you, the way that we know we should go, but we believe that there's another way. In our minds, we believe that there's our way, there's our direction. And if we're wise, we will find that the way that our parents told us was right. Have you found that to be true? Mom and dad were right. But we want to find our right way. You know, there's only one truth, isn't there? There's only one truth. A half truth is a whole lie. There's only one truth. It's like having two watches. If you have one watch, you know what time it is. If you have two watches, you're never sure. One watch may say you're on time. The other watch may say you're late. You can't have time and set time by two different watches. You can't have your way and God's way. One way is the right way. And if we're wise, we'll try to find God's way. We'll set our time to God's time and God's timetable, and we'll follow God's pathway. That's if we're wise. If we're unwise, we'll consistently try to find our way away from God. And you'll find that the further you get away from God, the more darkness shows up. God is light. And as you venture away from the light because you know better, you'll find darkness keeps showing up. And we're stubborn sometimes. We want to keep trying to find our way out of darkness by going deeper into darkness. You can't find your way out of darkness by getting deeper into darkness. We find our way out by gravitating toward the light. But that takes humility. We were talking this morning about prayer in our class. It says, well, why do people kneel and pray? You don't have to kneel and pray. But your humility, your allegiance to God causes you to bow and show respect. And when you kneel, you are showing your respect. You're humbling and lowering yourself. And back during the days of the Old Testament, if you went before the king, you had to kneel. There's no way you approach the king without kneeling and bowing your head. And you didn't raise your head until you were permitted to raise up. You do not look upon the face of God. You bow your head, you humbly submit yourself to God when you pray. He's saying the way we do it is the way that God looks at our hearts when we approach him, is how our hearts come to God. You don't come to God with your head, your pride. You come to God with your heart being humble, and you humble yourself before him. God's ways are not our ways. In Jeremiah chapter 29 and verse number 11, his ways are not our ways. It says, "For I know the thoughts..." In other words, the plans that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. For it says, I know the plans. Now, we have insurance plans. We have health plan. We have retirement plans. But God also has a plan. Plans to prosper us and not to harm us. Plans to give us hope and a future. This past week, there was a lot of people who have concerns, or a lot of concerns this past week because of the inauguration. A lot of people were concerned about the future and the plans, and what's going to happen. Here's one thing that I'm certain about. God's not worried. God's not concerned about what's going to happen. He already sees the end at the beginning. And when we put our trust where our trust really belongs, our trust, our hope, our future is in God's hands. Whenever you put your trust and your hope and your future in anyone's hands other than God, you have just misplaced your priorities. God is in control. Is that right? We said God is on the move. God is never silent. God is speaking to you right now. Still and know that I am God. And no matter what these years brings, knows that God will make everything work out together for your good. Even evil, God will turn around and make happen for good. If you love the Lord and following him, he will make everything work out for your good. So we should have confidence going in, especially those that are believers. As the world is in trouble and in peril and confused and anguish, we should have peace. Our greatest impact on the world is when we're least like the world. When the world's all frustrated and angry and upset, we are confident and we are secure because we know where our hope is. When the world's hot, we're cool. We're not going to go the direction that the world goes because we know that God has a perfect plan. And you know, God will use anyone that he wants to show his might. Here we're going into an administration and we may have concerns, but coming out of this, we may look back and say, I don't know how God did that, but I know it had to have been God. To see God's power and God's might, when my people, he says, humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. If we will place our trust in him, he will never steer us wrong. If we have our confidence in him, that's what God needs. Their faith will always be blessed if they will continue to put their trust and hope in God. Can I get an amen on that? Amen. Amen. Just put our trust and hope in God. James chapter number 1 and verse number 5 shares with us that we can have confidence in God. But if we just do not doubt, trust in him with all of our ways, do not doubt. Because a person that doubts is like a wave of the sea. Put your trust in God, knowing that he is the one that secures us. When there's unsteadiness in your life, the question is, what happened to your trust? Did you start trusting in what you can see? Or trusting in what God's already given you? In the midnight hour, you'll hear and feel a calmness, a stillness where God will come in and trust him that everything is going to be all right. Psalm chapter number 30 and verse number 5 says, weeping endures through the night, but joy comes in the morning. Sometimes we sow in tears. When you cry sometimes, you're sowing tears. And God will take those tears and he'll reap joy from your suffering. That's what God does. Turn those tears into joy. But we have to trust in him and just pour our hearts out to him. When you pour your heart out to God, he hears not what you say, he hears the expression of your heart. And sometimes there are words that cannot be expressed. It can only be expressed through your spirit and sometimes through your tears. We were talking a little earlier also about fasting. I don't know if anybody ever fasts. You ever fast for religious reasons or health reasons, fasting? And your assignment this week is you better fast. Fasting, to me, is one of the things that allows God's presence to really come in like you've never had it before. Because fasting means denying self. Denying self. Now, there are different ways to fast. The scripture always talks about fasting means denying yourself of food. That's how scriptural, biblically. You don't see in scripture where it says fasting internet, or fasting Starbucks, or fasting, whatever else that you may do. It really talks about food. And then many places, food and water, where you go and fast. But when you fast, you're really allowing God, during the times you're fasting, to have control because you're denying your flesh. Your body loves to eat. But when you fast, you're saying, God, I'm denying what I love, and I want you to take control of me. And I want to give my time when I would eat to time to prayer and submit myself to you. So when you fast, you're allowing God to come in and start to cleansing you. Now, if you fast, what you'll notice immediately is an attack from the enemy. And the enemy is everything that wants to control you. Your mind will attack you. Your flesh will attack you. You'll find that there's something that's trying to oppose this opportunity for you to really do something that is sacred. And when you get into a fasting posture, the enemy is threatened. That's why he doesn't want you to fast. When I ask how many people have fasted, not many people raise their hand. But you pray. The enemy does not mind you praying. But he knows that fasting is your way of really bringing you in closer relationship with God. Try this sometime. Maybe you'll fast for maybe just a whole from morning until evening. And you say, I'm going to declare a fast for just one day. And watch what happens during that day. You'll notice during the first few hours, everything about you will try and oppose and make you want to eat something. Because fasting to God is such a valuable source and an opportunity for you to commune with Him, that when you start fasting, your spirit starts aligning itself with God. And everything else that does not want you to be aligned with God is going to try and pull you away. When I fasted the first time, everything smelled like meat. I'd hug Kim and she smelled like bacon. I'm like, oh man, you know, you smell like bacon too. And I love bacon, you know, bacon. Whoa, wow. You pass by, you know, you sit in your car, and you say, I smell bread, that's bread somewhere. Your senses will tell you to eat something. And I remember I fasted, it was like I was hungry and grouchy and upset, and it's just the worst 15 minutes of my life. But if you persist in doing that, you'll find out that your help comes from God. When you are doing something for the right reasons and God is in you, He gives you the support and the strength you need to make it through the journey. That's what you learn, is that you have a comforter and you have a helper, and as you allow Him, He will be able to take you through whatever it is that you need to go through. And that's why when you fast, you feel His presence. When you don't fast, you're really allowing yourself to try and go through the best way that you can. And we often try to do that without God. And it's sad to me to see people that do much of their life without God, and they're struggling. And my question is, how is that working for you so far? Isn't it time that you wise up and realize that there's a better way, that God has a better plan, that your plan may not be working? Because every direction that you're going takes you someplace. And you may go out there and find out that this is not the place. So you got to find another direction. And you go there for a while. Then you go over here for a while. And you keep going and you find out that you keep going nowhere fast. But if you follow God's plan, He'll take you where you need to go. And that's what God ultimately wants you to do. Just trust Him. Trust me. Follow His plan. God is our Redeemer. Isaiah chapter 43. And God tells us what we're going to go through. But when we go through some things, He's saying, I've already redeemed you. Being saved and being a child of God does not mean that you will not go through some trouble, some tribulations, some hardships. Is that right? It's not our get out of jail free card. If they come and pick you up, police come, and you say, no, but I'm saved. You're going to go with them. It's okay. You'll be saved, but God will go with you. The thing is, whatever you go through, you do never go through it by yourself. And when you have Him with you, that means that He's going to teach you something in every place that you go. There's some lessons we can only learn that are hard. Why is that? Why can we learn it while it's easy? Some of us can only learn hard lessons. We have to touch the stove to find out that it's really hot. We have to get burned. And God knows that. You know, a good parent will let a child go through some things, and then right the way it is. A good parent will watch a child go through this and say, oh, this is going to hurt. Oh, and yet watch you go through that. A bad parent will be, no, baby, come here. Let mama help you. Let mama help you. Let mama help you. He's 25 years old. Hey, let mama help you. Hold on. Mama take care of you. At some point, they have to learn to trust God in everything. He's our Redeemer. Now, here's what he told us in Isaiah chapter 43. But now thus says the Lord who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. That means I bought you back. I have called you by your name. You are mine. That's great news. God's saying, you're mine. No matter how far you go out there, you're mine. You know, your parents may let you go, but you know you can always call home, can't you? You're mine. When my dad would come and all the kids would be out there and my dad would call, I responded because I was his. I heard his voice. I responded because I am his. When you know God is calling, you respond to his voice. The one who does not respond is trying to reject the authority of parentship or the authority of God in your life. When you've been out there, you've heard God calling you. You've been out there, but you just not want to hear God's voice. You've been out there so far, you don't want to hear God's voice. You don't want to hear your parents' voice. And whatever sounds right, you don't want to hear anything that's good. That means you're really out there. It's called a reprobate mind. When you don't want to hear anybody telling you anything that's good, God is calling you. He says, you're mine. I redeemed you. You may not want to hear me, but I'm calling you. In verse number 2, when you pass through the waters, not if you pass through. He's saying you're going to go through some things. When you go through, remember that you are mine. Remember, I have redeemed you. This will not harm you. Remember, when you go through this, when you go through the waters, I will be what? With you. That's the good news. Wherever you've gone, he says, I've been with you. I've been with you. Way back when you went through the issues in your life, I was with you. When you went through the accident, I was with you. When you had the death of a loved one, I was with you. The divorce, I was with you. When you went through the surgery, I was with you. And you look back and know that he was always with you. He's been faithful. He has never left you. You may have left him, but he has never left you. His promises are true and he is faithful. He has never left us. He says, but when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, nor shall the flame scorch you. The accidents that you see sometime on the freeway were meant for you. But God says, I was with you. That's why you were able to pass by. You passed by a lot of things that may have been meant for you, but it did not happen for you because he was with you. You'll see people fall on your right side or on your left side, but he was with you. You've got friends right now that are no longer here, but God says, I was with you. That's why it was them and not you. Do not think that it was because you were just lucky. I was with you. You are mine. He says, I redeemed you. And it's not because of what you've done. You had a mother like Lena who prayed for you. You have somebody who prayed for you, who had you on their mind. When you out there like you have lost your mind, they were praying for you and had you on their mind. Let's give God praise for somebody who's praying for us. I'm so glad for mama's prayers. I'm so glad that they were praying for you. They were saying, God, just watch over my child out there. I know he's out there, God. I know they're doing something that's not right. But God, I know that I have claimed them for you, God. They are yours. They are your children. God, be with them and guard them. And while you're out there trying to party, they're out there praying for you. They're just giving God glory on your behalf. And God's saying that I've covered you. You didn't know that angels were encamped around you. That God has protection around you when you're out there because he loves you that much. And some people still don't think that they owe God anything as much as he has done for you. We owe God everything. Is that right? Let's give God one more round of praise. We owe him everything. Whether we believe we do or not, we owe him our everything. God is our Redeemer. Proverbs chapter 16 and verse number 7, 16 and 7. And here's what he promises us. That when a man's, and this applies to women too, but when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. That's the good news. Even your enemies will be at peace with you because you're blessed. The Bible says you should bless those that are blessed. And he says, whoever curses you, he says, I will curse. When you are sacred and you are really one of God, he says, people around you better be careful how they treat you. They should bless you because I will bless those that bless you. I will curse those that curse you. So you should tell your enemies, you know I'm blessed, don't you? Do you know I'm blessed? Just letting you know. I mean, in case you got some issues, I'm blessed. Yeah. So those that intend to do you harm should be careful around you because God has blessed you. And he says, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And we should be about blessing people. In every way, we should find a way to be a blessing and be a service to somebody. Because when you do good, it allows them to see God in you. Because every good thing, every perfect thing, every right thing, everything that is true comes ultimately from God. So when you do it, you're allowing somebody in some way to see a little bit of God. You don't have to go around and parade with your Bible and say bless you and have a big cross. Just do the good. The good speaks for itself. You don't have to defend God. When you are really about him, people know it. And then people know a show, too. When you get up there, you want to be a show for God. And on Sundays, we have people that in church, they can show out. Because I've seen people in church when I grew up on church, they're jumping around, they're shouting for God. And then they're cursing people out the next day. We have responsibility to God. I'm going to close now. We have responsibility to God. In Proverbs 16 and verse number 3. Commit your works to the Lord, and your thoughts will be established. Whatever you do, do it as unto the Lord. That's who you do. You work, not for your boss. You work as unto the Lord. You live, you breathe, you love as unto the Lord. Everything that you do should bring glory back to God. I do this so that you think about the Lord and whatever he has done for you, you give glory back to God in what you do, your service, your work. People that come into your life, when you're ultimately doing all you do as unto the Lord, they begin to see him and not you. That's what God wants us to be, a living witness. So when people start seeing you, they don't see you anymore. They start to feel the presence of God when they come around you, and they like being around you because there's something about you that revives them, that gives them a sense of being, of knowing that there's worth in their life. Validate people. Let them know that they're special. Let them know that they're important. Lift them up. Be an encourager. And in doing so, you'll be amazed God will lift you up. You ever have a down day and you encourage somebody and your day is better? Because there's no way that you can give out that kind of good without good coming back to you. Thank you, God. There's no way that you can have him on the inside of you without it coming out of you. You squeeze an orange, you get orange juice. You squeeze an apple, you get apple juice. You squeeze a child of God, you should get the joy of Jesus coming out. The more pressure on the outside brings out more Jesus on the inside. That's real life, that when you are really about him, in your worst days, you're going to praise him. You're going to give him joy. You're going to give him glory. It's like when the storm came and the roof and the chicken coop was all destroyed, and the rooster got up on top of the chicken coop, and everything he had was under his feet. But the rooster got up, and he began to crow, because crowing is what he does. In your worst days, you're still going to give God praise, because praise is what you do. If it's inside of you in your worst days, you're going to still have to find something to praise God for. Not for the worst of things. You praise him for the best because your best days are still ahead. If he gives you breath and life, you got something to be praising God for because tomorrow brings a better day, a new hope, a new glory. Old things, the Bible says, are passed away. And behold, all things in your life are new, beginning right now. And we should be thanking God for what he's brought you through. It may not have been the best of situations. There may have been some bad things that happened. Some bad people have done things to you. But God, you brought me through that. You have redeemed me. I'm yours. And God, I'm grateful. And we go through with our mind stayed on Jesus. An attitude of gratitude and a posture of praise. Every day I wake up with my mind stayed on Jesus.